What is it?
Like, why is it how are you?
It's always BB.
I am. BB.
BB, BB. This is dope.
Benzene would be the one that you would be most likely to see because it actually has bands in the UV vis range without being conjugated, even though they are weak. Our alkene, alcohol, and amines all fall below our 200 nanometer cutoff for what we can usually see.
Here's the picture.
Calculations for lambda max values are not typically done for which of the following chromophores? Thank you. you to use for the calculation of the land and land values. Considered a cysoid double bond, we would use cysoid. Using the Wibbert-Fisher rules, how many exocyclic double bonds should be accounted for?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
I was
thinking to the molecular ion. I was just paying attention to the fact that I like the electron only because you can see all the fragments, which you can learn more about the molecule, which is what I'm like, most useful. Okay, that's most useful for organic.
Nope.
Really should have read better.
Alright, so today we're going to finish up talking about the mass spectrum itself. My spectrum error, I should say. And then we were going to analyzing the mass spectrum. We're going to talk about molecular ions and how the molecules themselves actually ionize, and then their fragmentation patterns. And then hopefully get to some of the spectra that I posted later, much later today, about noon. And we'll go over those again on Friday. Your homework is due on Friday, and then your, just wanted to remind you that the project is posted for the next, or it's posted on Blackboard under group project, and the wiki there is where you sign up for your desired project stuff. It's under group project button. And just in case you feel like deleting someone or re-erasing their names, I can't go through the history of it, so don't do that. Take one.
That's sketchy. Just
kidding.
Of course. It's gonna de-hair fleece you.
Okay.
It is so pretty.
But let's finish up with the master summary. The first part of this video on Monday. Now we're going to look at the mass analyzer. So here is where the mass of the different ions is going to cause them to separate out to different mass to charge ratios so that we can actually detect them. And in some way, we have to separate those out before they get to the detector. And they will all hit the detector at different times, and that's how we determine the mass-to-charge ratio. And that part, the detection part, is all computational, of course, so whenever the ion hits it, it knows that whichever method's being used, it can calculate what the mass-to-charge ratio is. And there's several different ways of separating out the ions. We'll go through them relatively quickly. This is the first one, which is the
bless you.
Magnetic sector analyzer.
Where an electromagnet produces a vertical magnetic field. This further deflects the beam in an arc of a circle. On emerging from the magnetic field, the beam is deflected again by another set of charged plates which direct it into the detector. The amount of deflection by the magnetic field depends on the mass of the ion, strictly its mass to charge ratio, but the vast majority of ions have only a single charge. The deflection also depends on the strength of the field. Heavier ions will not be deflected sufficiently in the magnetic field to reach the detector. Light ions will be deflected too much. During a run, the magnetic field is gradually increased so that ions of successively greater mass enter the detector. The mass spectrum of limonene looks like this. Each vertical line...
So as you saw there, by varying the magnetic field, the different ions would get either hitting one side or other of the walls, or they'd go directly through. So if you have one magnetic field and the ion goes through, you can calculate what the mass to charge ratio is based on that magnetic field and the equation given in the book. I won't expect you to do those exact calculations, but if you increase the magnetic field, it's going to cause different ions to make the pathway through, and the others are going to be hitting the sides and not being hitting the detector. So by varying it through the range of magnetic fields to get all the different mass to charge ratios that you're analyzing for, you're able to detect the different ones. There are several different types of these detectors. And they have similar... going to separate it on that curve. The time of flight analyzer, essentially you have the ions coming through. Your heavier ions are going to go slower than your lighter ions. In the detector here, is going to detect the smallest ions first, and then it's going to detect the larger ones. It just depends on how long it takes those ions to get to the detector. So the time of flight is just what it says. How long does it take to get from this ionization chamber to the detector? And computationally, that's determined for the mass defect ratio. The quadrupole analyzer, well, let me step back. So the magnetic sector analyzer, you noticed that that was a very large instrument. So you have to have a pretty large instrument in order to do the magnetic sector analyzer. But a nice thing about it is that it can get pretty high resolution. So you can do high resolution mass spec on the magnetic sector analyzer. The time of flight is also a large instrument, but it's not quite as accurate as the magnetic sector, and typically good for your high mass to charge ratio, so when you have those really big molecules that we were talking about. The quadrupole has four poles, cylinders. Essentially, there's a cylinder of these four. And the ions are going to go through the middle, which is not very good in my perspective, Charlie. But there's going to be these four cylinders, and the ions are going to go through the middle. Let's create one of these. Here's my quadrupole. Your ions are going to go in the middle here, through the middle of the pathway, right? This is going to vary the electric current through these. And same way, the different ions are going to either go straight through, depending on the current in all the quadrupoles, or they're going to get deflected and hit the sides and not make it to our detector. And if you vary the current going through the quadrupole, you're able to get different mass to charge ratios and again be able to analyze for the different masses. And this has a limited mass range. It's approximately 10,000 molecular weight would it be its max.
10,000 or
1,000 molecular weight would be about its max. So we're talking small molecules for these. And it is not high res. The benefit of this is it's actually very quick. And so it can do about 20 to 800 mass to charge ratio in 1 second. And so that is beneficial when you need the quick applications like for an LC-MS or a GC-MS. Those can be quite useful. The ion trap is the kind that we have. Videos. So there's basically this cylinder in here. Your molecules are going to be circulating in there, and the smaller molecules are going to precess or circulate in there at a different speed than the larger molecules. And they're able to separate out the different mass to charge ratios based on how fast they are circulating. And then they're able to selectively let some of them through to the detector and then others. So here they're, now you can see them precessing, the smaller ones going through first, going to the detector. Then you have the slightly larger ones, and it's going to cycle through all of those, and then eventually eject them all out. This is actually, it seems like it'd take a long time, but it's actually a pretty good technique. We have this on our GCMS, and it's a very fast cycle, again, so it can be used for LCMS or GCMS. And it's typically not the high resolution. They're making advances in these things now, but that's not one. Well, they're not quite there yet. The last one here is the ion cyclotron, which, yeah. That's the page of my notes I'm missing. Lovely. There's another way of separating out the mass to charge ratios.
Cool.
Now the detector on these are going to basically be the plate that they're getting. There's also the description in the book talks about the mass amplification, so you, or multiplier, so that you can get a stronger signal for the masses, because we are analyzing single ions here. So if you're just looking at a few single ions, you want to get as much signal as you can in the detector. That's essentially all I wanted to talk about with the instrumentation. Do you have any other questions for that? Do you want to get into analyzing it? Determine a molecular formula, typically by rule of 13 or one of the other methods. But you want to be careful with these. This is the chart from the book that talks about the relative stability of our molecular ions. So our alcohols and our branched hydrocarbons, carboxylic acids, are all very unstable when they're ionized, and they fall apart really easily. This means that it's very unlikely that you're going to even see these in the mass spectrum. As we go up, the functional groups become a bit more stable, but there's never a guarantee that you're going to see the molecular ion for any of these. And that is the drawback of the electron ionization technique. The rest of the chapter talks about things in terms of electron ionization. So we're going to be focused on electron ionization because it is the most commonly used one. But it does have the drawback that you can lose your molecular ion when you get it too excited. So what are some criteria we should use when we're looking at our molecular ion? So it is highest mass peak, excluding the isotopes. Remember, we talked about our M plus 1 and our M plus 2, so don't consider those as your highest mass to charge ratio. It must account for all fragments.
So when you say highest, you're not talking about intensity, right?
No, the highest in the mass to charge ratio. On the x-axis. The molecular ion has to be the source of all the fragments that we're seeing, so there needs to be reasonable losses from that to form the other peaks in the mass spectrum, which would be our fragments. And this is through the loss of stable radicals. From this, we know that your M plus 1 peak is going to be affected by the number of carbons that are in your molecule. Proportionally, as the number of carbons in the molecule go up, the probability that you're going to have a carbon 13 is going to go up. And so if you have 10 carbons in your molecule, then you would have a higher chance of having a carbon 13 than if you had 5 carbons in your molecule. And so the ratio of your M plus to M plus 1 is going to vary accordingly. And I'm just going to write out the equation from the book, or a sum of that. So the percent relative abundance of your M plus 1 peak is going to be equal to the sum of the percent natural abundance of element N times the number of atoms of N in the ion. For our M plus 1, this is going to include the found in your books also includes a few more, because I got a little bit more particular about what ions they were looking at. To silicon and sulfur and added those into the equation as well as deuterium. Now deuterium does not affect the M+1 peak very significantly unless you have lots of hydrogens because it's only a 0.016% abundance of deuterium in nature. When you start talking about very large molecular weight things, though, if you're talking about a protein, then there's a lot more hydrogens that comes into effect more. And so that is accounted for in their equation, which they give here, where the hydrogen, number of hydrogens times that 0.015. It also adds in the nitrogens, the oxygens, the sulfur, and the silicon. And I don't expect you to memorize all of those percent abundances, but you should know if you were given the table how to calculate the M+1 peak. The M+2 peak is a little bit simpler here. So we have the number of carbons times the 1.1. Have to have two carbon 13s in the molecule in order to get a M+2 peak. This happens when you have a lot more carbons in your structure than, say, 5. You're not going to see that very much. But if you have 100 carbons in your structure, you are going to see a significant M+2 peak. And they're proportionally smaller as we go down. And then adding in the number of oxygens times 0.2 for the percent abundance of that, and the number of sulfur times 4.4 plus the number of silicon times 3.4. For that calculation, we are not considering the number of carbon or chlorines or bromines that may be encountered in the M+2 peak. And so this is your base one. So if you see an abnormally large M+2 peak, you're going to start thinking chlorine and bromine. I am getting a copy of the next thing made or a scan made so that you can see this table. It's the Saturn GCMS Mass Spectral Interpretation Guide, and it's a summary of different fragmentation patterns that they have, as well as some additional information like the halogen incorporation. So here, we look, let's start at the top. If you have one chlorine, and we look at your M+2 peak, you're going to see the 3-to-1 ratio. But if you get two chlorines in your molecule, you're now going to have the possibility of having two chlorines that are 35, one chlorine that's 35 and one that's 37, or both being 37. And you start seeing additional peaks for the M+4 peak now, and it's going to be proportional as we go down. If you have three Cls, well, you have to calculate, okay, what's the probability of having a 35, a 37, and the different combinations. and they have nice tables here. The bromine is actually really nice if we look at bromine. So if we just look at that section, notice anything about those? It's like NMR, doesn't it? We've got a doublet, a triplet, a quartet, and a quintet with the same type of ratios. Because bromine is 1 to 1 of the two isotopes, 79 to 81. So if you have one of them in there, you got an equal ratio. If you have two of them, well, you'd have one part that's going to be both the lower one. Two possibilities of having 79 and 81. And then one possibility of having 81 and 81. And so it looks like the triplet. So be aware that there can be more than one halogen in a structure. And we'll get back to that in a little bit. Let's come back to our table here. There, our PowerPoint. So you can calculate the M plus 1 to a little bit more accuracy than we were doing it with the just dividing by 1.1. And this is why dividing by 1.1 will tell you approximately how many carbons you have, but it doesn't tell you exactly because the, the carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, and silicon can all affect it. And it depends on how strong your M plus peak is as well, to how accurate your data is going to be. Now we're going to talk about the ionization of the molecules. So as we saw in the quiz, the electron that gets ejected is going to be from the highest molecular orbital, or highest energy molecular orbital. So this is a shortened version of the graph I drew for the UV Viz when we were talking about transitions. And if you remember, sigma is going to be our lowest energy, pi orbitals are going to be the next highest energy, and then n orbitals are going to be the highest energy. So if you have an n orbital, that's going to be the one that is ejected. So n orbital, if you recall, is the non-bonding electrons. If you have some type of heteroatom in your structure, so something other than carbon or oxygen, it's likely that you're going to have a pair of electrons on that atom. So oxygen here has a pair of electrons. When it's ionized, we're going to see the loss of one of the electrons from one of those lone pairs. And if we calculate the formal charge on oxygen at that point, it's missing an electron, so it's going to have a positive charge. If there is not an N bond, we're going to excite one from a pi bond. So the pi bond is going to lose one electron. We're going to be left with one electron and a positive charge as one way to represent this. Often, though, these are represented as just a put the alkene there and then put the little bracket on the side and say, no, it's a radical cation. But I want you to know approximately where you're getting ionized from. The next example has an oxygen and a double bond. But the oxygen non-bonding electrons are going to be higher in energy, so this one is going to be N again. And we're going to get the ionized electron out of the non-bonding oxygen orbital. If you cannot do any of the above, and it's still getting ionized, it's going to be a sigma bond, which is not the easiest thing. And one example of that might be positive charge than the radical there.
So it's just one bracket
mm-hmm.
on the side?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So then with that first representation of the alkene, that's still bonded, it's just a single layer.
Yeah,
okay.
so
it's just
a very high energy, right?
So it's just a very weird way to show.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's very high energy. We had to take one electron out of somewhere. And the best we could do was one of the bonds, the sigma bonds. And that's why it just starts falling apart, right? You've broken or almost broken the bond. It's ready to just take it.
With the pi bond ionized molecule,
mm-hmm.
the second one, you have an alkene, then you have a little alkene.
This one?
Yeah, is there two different molecules?
Yeah, two different representations
no.
of how you would draw it.
No, I'm in the bracket thing. Like, are those two different molecules? Is an alkene and then an alkane with a pi?
No, this is the bracket thing that I was talking about.
I don't understand.
It's a bracket, not a bracket.
You know, but
yeah. Like, if I were...
Or is the other bracket?
There is open-ended brackets, just on one side.
So you're just saying that the alkene has a radical and has a positive?
Yes. And we're too lazy to draw it all the way around the molecule, I guess. So that's a true story. Stable carbocations as much as possible in the that's Stevenson's rules. Basically, the fragment with the lowest ionization potential takes the charge. The most stable carbocation is going to want to take the charge. If you have two and you're debating between a primary and a secondary, the secondary is going to be more likely. This also means that when you're looking at a mass spec, the more abundant ions are probably the more stable of these cations. And so we're going to look at some where you have primary carbocations that can be formed in secondary, and the secondary are going to be more abundant, relatively. Okay, a couple more rules for fragmentation. Even electron rule. If you have an on electron carbocation, that radical carbocation, that can fragment in two ways. It can give us another on electron radical cation plus a neutral molecule. So N is some neutral molecule. Example may be water. Here we're losing an equivalent of water. The odd electron radical carbocation can also fragment to give us the even electron carbocation plus a radical. In this case, one portion of the molecule took the plus charge, the other took the electron, and they went their separate ways. If we have an even electron species, it can only go to an even electron species. There's no more radicals. And it can do the even electron plus some N or neutral molecule.
So is it even electrons with or without the radical?
It does not have a radical. Yes.
Why not?
Well, it's probably lost the radical here.
Okay.
Right? That generally, these are formed by a fragmentation pattern. And just because something fragments once does not mean it won't fragment again. Because we still have high energy intermediates that may want to fragment it again. So it cannot do the odd electron fragmentation. Finally, a review on how bonds break. Heterolytic on breakage is you have A bonded to B, and each of them takes a pair of electrons, or not a pair, each of them takes a single electron and goes on their separate ways, and you get two radicals. A homolytic bond cleavage. One of the atoms takes both pairs of electrons and ends up with a charge, or charge separation on both of those. Note the notation I'm using to indicate that. So when you use a heterolytic bond cleavage, one electron goes in either way, and we use the fish hook with just one barb on the arrow. In the homolytic, it takes both electrons, so you use the double-headed arrow. We're going to look at slightly more complicated ones because they're going to be radical cations, and so we're going to have to keep track of where the cations and the radicals go. So make sure you track those. just from the outset here, unreasonable losses. It is very unlikely that you would have M minus any of these. So M minus anything between 3 and 14, and 21 to 26. We do not have a combination of elements that's going to add up to 3 that's typically in an organic molecule. And same goes for anything up till 14, and then there's another gap between 21 and 26. So if you're finding fragments that are those numbers, go back to the original thinking, maybe this is not my molecular ion. Maybe there's a problem there.
Okay.
Let's go over a couple of types of fragments, hopefully here. So in alpha cleavage, if we look at this could be one of two ways. First, you can have an R group, the CH, CH. And I'm going to do this just as a standard radical cation. But let's say that this bond was the one that had the one electron, and now this carbon is just going to take it, and it's going to fragment into R, CH. To a plus charge on one side and a radical on the other. If we look at these, there's two fragments, but only the carbocation is going to be detected. Remember, we only see the charged species. But we can infer what this is based on a M minus some number. So this is going to be whatever the new mass to charge ratio is, and we can subtract that from our M plus and see what has been lost. This is when you want to refer to the tables as to what are reasonable losses, and this section of this handout has lists of reasonable numbers and what's associated with what's being lost in those. And once that gets scanned in, I'll get it posted on Blackboard.
That's all we have time for today.
So, we're going to finish this up on Reddit.